Welcome to session 8. In this session, we will introduce the plant kingdom. Plant remedies are often hard to recognize. Therefore, we will explain what to look for in these cases. We'll start exploring the plant families that are known for their pain sensation. These are, amongst others, the Ranunculaceae, the Papaveraceae, and the Compositae. Enjoy this session.
Hi, this is session 8 of the advanced course, The Vital Approach, and today we are going to talk about plants. It might have occurred to you that in our Materia Medica, the majority of our remedies are plant remedies, of which a lot are never used. And there are several reasons for that. We have a lot of plants, incomplete provings, so we only have a partial drug picture. Or we only know the poisoning symptoms, because many plants are poisonous, as you know. Or we only know the news in herbal medicine, and then mostly they use tinctures, and the effect is totally different. Or maybe because there are so many plants, and we have a hard time to remember them. Now, since we have the analysis and the understanding of kingdoms and miasms, a lot of remedies, plant remedies that we never used before, come now to our disposal. Let's have a look at the general kingdom characteristics shared by all plant remedies. So, you might have read in the books that plants are sensitive, and sensitivity is their main characteristic. And although it's true, it is a bit confusing because everybody is sensitive to his own problem. And sensitivity often is confused for emotionality, which is not the same. And on the other hand, we have patients who don't show any sensitivity at all. They try to hide it, they're highly compensated, they don't show their emotionality, and we think they are distant and they are a little bit aloof, and they walk out of your office with a mineral remedy. So I think reactivity is a better word. It means that plants are affected by, touched by their surroundings, everything in their surroundings, and they react immediately. They do it automatically, without thinking. They do it constantly, and they don't even notice it. For them, it's a normal way of being. So they react to rocks and stones, to the landscapes, to the weather, to changes in their surroundings, to, of course, to plants, to animals, to humans, to everything. And even when they don't tell you directly, you will notice when they tell you about their characteristics and their likes and dislikes that they have a collection of shells or collection of crystals, or they talk about their travels, how much they like to be at the seaside or in the mountains, or they have green fingers and they love plants and gardening and flowers and perfume. Or maybe they talk about their favorite pets and how they love this animal, or animals they dislike or they are afraid of. It will be anywhere. And by all this reactivity, you will realize that you are in plant kingdom. Most likely, they will prefer activity outdoors because plants need air and light. Also, it's possible they will talk about their love for certain animals or talk in length about their favorite pet. And you might think about an animal remedy because they're so relating to the animal or projecting so many feelings and emotions to the animal. They feel what the animal feels. Another important feature in your consultation is the context. We talked about this before. It's the way the patients relate to you, the way they look, the way they act, the way they relate and talk to the homeopath, and the way the consultation evolves. So in a plant case, in general, that you have a very lively speech, they relate to the homeopath, and they will ask, how are you, and how was your weekend, and how's your daughter, since they know something about your private life, they will inquire, how are you? And then they will talk about themselves, and you will get many, many expressions, many images, many different sensitivities because they are so easily affected. And in homeopathic jargon, we translate this in many symptoms and many modalities. And this plentitude and variety in itself is a pointer to the plant kingdom. Sometimes the homeopath will have a hard time noting everything down that the patient will tell you, because story after story, and there's another image, and there's another example, and a lot of anecdotes. And the homeopath can feel overwhelmed by too much information. So if you have this feeling as a homeopath, if you don't see the bush for the trees, probably you are in plant kingdom. In the consultation, after the first round, you start questioning your patient. Now, a plant remedy will answer your question with another story. And this is in contrast with a mineral remedy. A mineral remedy will answer your question with a definition. For instance, you ask, what do you mean by difficult? And the mineral will say, by difficult, I mean it is hard to achieve. Something like that. It's just an example. A plant remedy will say, for instance, by difficult, I mean, well, you know, for example, last week when I went shopping because I was looking for those blue boots that fit with my winter coat, and I came from the store at the corner. You know, there's a new store there, but it was too expensive, so I didn't buy anything. And I just came out of the store, and then I bumped into a man that was a former neighbor of my parents when they still lived at the country house, you see. And this man came to me and he said, aren't you? And he was talking and etc, etc, etc. And you get the whole picture, the whole story. And at the end of the story, they will conclude, this is what I mean by difficult. So you'll get a complete image. You will get all details. It's almost like they open a chapter, a new chapter in a novel, and there the whole scene comes, or a scene on television, or a picture, an image with all details, all colors and smells. And it contains the message. That is important for us. The story is not coincidental. So these kind of patients, you might think, but why do they keep telling story after story? And how can I get them to some deeper level? How can I make them tell me the vital sensation that is underneath? But I found in my cases, as I said, the story is never coincidental. At the contrary. So by case after case after case, I learned that the patient picks out the best scenery to convey the message. It's unconscious, and they don't know, they're not aware that they're doing this, but somewhere on an unconscious level, they must know that this is, or they had the experience that this is the occasion or the situation where they felt the vital sensation. So it is the message that is conveyed by this particular story. They picked it out from a million possibilities. So it must be a good example. And it's very important to us to try to understand what do they try to tell us? What is the message that is hidden in it? And either you understand, either they say it, or you understand it because it's clear, or you can ask for it. You can just ask your patient, I see, so this and this happened, and then this is what you did, and this is what the other person said, and this is what how you reacted. So how was it for you in this situation? How did you experience it? And then they will tell you, actually, if they didn't do it before, they will tell you the vital sensation. So often we think it's only level 3. We think it's only story. We think it's not useful. It's a bit superficial. We have to aim at level 5, don't we? So there's 2 more levels to go. And we can't make the patient say something deeper. Because even if you ask, how did you feel, or how was your experience in this story, just another emotion can come, or just another level 3 word might come up. And this is because plant sensations are expressed in those very common words. They're not something special, something deeper, something never heard. They are very daily expressions, and they are used all of the time. And that's why they escape our attention. Those words like pain and hurt and connected and shocked and stuck and broken or moving or burning or attached to, all those words, we use them so often that we don't even notice them. This means many patients who don't need plant remedies will use them as well. And unfortunately, patients who do need plant remedies might not use them directly. Maybe they will use the word indirectly, the word we used, you know, the need, the sensation word. Because according to the Myasem, they can be very compensated. And compensated patients won't give their feelings freely. They will compensate them, they will hide them. So the question, our next question then is, if we have noticed that the patient is very compensated and it's very close and very reserved and you can't make them talk freely about his emotions, then we have to ask ourselves, who needs to hide this emotionality which is obviously there? It must be a very sensitive patient who cannot afford himself, who cannot let himself freely feel these emotions, be aware of these emotions, who are there. And then the other question is, what kind of sensation, emotion is he trying to hide from us and himself? Why? What is it that he doesn't want to show? And that is what we are looking for. And sometimes we only will have this information indirect because he denies something or he's just a contrary, or, you know, he's contraphobic. Eh? I'm not afraid of big dogs, which is the same, I'm afraid of big dogs. So, if this vital sensation in plants is so common or expressed in such common words, how will we know the difference between level 3, common human emotions, and level 5, vital sensation? This is, of course, the main important question during consultation. So the examples of the words and feelings just mentioned belong to the scala of human emotions. There are human experiences, but in order to need a plant, in order to be vital, there must be on the foreground of your case. That means it's not just one of those expressions, not one of those common daily expressions to tell you a story, but it's again and again and again. And it's on the foreground. It's the first thing they say and it's the last thing they say. And if you ask a question, this will be the final answer. There's nothing more. It is not like, oh my God, I was so shocked by this happening. And then when you question, how was it for you to be in this situation and being very shocked by this news, a mineral will go further. They will say, well, it was like falling down. It was like having no support. It was nothing to hold on anymore. That's mineral. So the shock goes to something else. If you ask an animal, oh, this shock, how was it for you in this situation? They might say, well, who are you then? You're nobody, you know? You're at the mercy of somebody else. What can you do? Meaning, I'm in an inferior position and the other was in a superior position. So it leads to something else. The shock, the word they use, leads to something else. If it's a plant, it doesn't lead to anything else because that's all there is. It's shock in mind, shock in body. And because they feel this, they are limited by it. Their conditions to be okay are defined by it. Being shocked and shattered and trying not to be, trying to control it or trying to avoid it, according to the Myasem. Finding a survival mechanism, as we say, a coping up mechanism, in order not to feel this. So you can try to prevent it, you can try to deny it, you can try to live with it, but the it is the vital sensation we are looking for. So if we hear in a case that the person tells you he is sad, everybody is sad now and then, it's human, but not everybody is a grief case. If a patient says, or talks about his uncertainties. Everybody is uncertain in some situation, but not everybody is a fourth row mineral. All patients, if you question them, will say that they prefer freedom, that they like freedom, they want to be free, but not everybody needs a bird. So in order to make it a whole case, it must be on the foreground, it must be repetitive, it must be the red thread through your case. It must hold when you question it. When they use the word, for instance, freedom, and you question freedom, that then, in order to be a bird case, it must be the last thing. It is their motivation, the first and last motivation to do whatever they do in life. And they will feel in many different situations that they are limited in their freedom. So in the same way, a plant sensation like stuck or like broken or like hurt must be in the foreground, triggered by whatever situation, and then it is vital. For instance, if the patient feels stuck, then he must feel stuck in the mind and stuck in the body, no matter what problem or difficulty comes up in his life, because the sensation is always there. We know that it's all levels, all of the time. But in order to be aware of it, there must be some difficulty or some problem in a patient's life. And then he will be aware of the vital sensation that is always there. That is what we like to know. So the stuck in mind and body all of the time is anacardiesi. It's not just one time, it's always there. Then the second part of the consultation, we know that, we talked about it in the session on anamnesis, is more of the same, as I said. So the first part is defining the territory. The person told you about the problems, the topics, the issues, and then we are asking questions about these features. So we look at it, the main complaint or the main complaints, can be more than one, and we look at it from all sides. We ask what, how, when, how many, what did you do about it, how did you feel, and more of the same. We broaden and deepen the information we have, and we look at it from every angle. But as the plant remedy patients give you so many stories, more stories are coming, and more stories of the same. We feel the same level. It's an example, another example, another example, but still the same level. Whereas in a mineral case, we have the feeling we delve deeper, or we build up. It's an image, yeah? What do you prefer? But we have the feeling it's same level stories. And there's so many, we can't follow, right, noting it down, and we tend to lose our attention. The one story piles on the other, and we get so many irrelevant details that we kind of or feel overwhelmed or kind of give up. But there's another thing, the patient, because he relates to the homeopath, he has contact, he tries to have contact with you, and we get caught up in the stories. They tell so many stories, and we can like go with them, be carried away by the stories, and then we lose our neutrality. Then we are not distant enough to listen to these vital words here and then. They're precious and rare, and they're covered in a lot of words and unnecessary details for us. So they get easily lost in the bulk of information, and we tend to get less attention because our attention span is maybe not that long. A consultation takes such a long time, and after an hour and a half, you know, the surprise is a bit less. The surprise when you see a patient for the first time, the things that are remarkable, we get used to our patient, the way he looks, the way he relates, the way he talks, and we kind of are less attentive and might lose the most important words we need. So a few tips maybe, that of course we have to listen to everything, we have to have our senses alert, but we specifically are listening for those words that don't fit, we know that. Eh? When a patient explains something, a whole story, and uses a lot of words and images and expressions, what is the thing that didn't fit? What is the thing that the word that you thought, that is a little bit unexpected, like I wouldn't use it, nobody else would use it, is actually the first time I ever heard the word in this situation or in this context. Or when the patient gives a sequence, and they often do, because they pile up words and synonyms, and there's one illogical in the sequence, that you are very alert to this illogical sequence, like what is this word doing there? The word in itself is not strange and rare and peculiar, but the moment it is used is strange and peculiar. And that is what we are doing, homeopaths, looking for the strange and peculiar. I can give you a few examples. There is, for instance, this case of this woman who had an accident. She fell off the stairs at night in her home. It was dark and she didn't see the stair, and she fell off. And so she was down, all black and blue, and maybe she broke something. She wasn't sure, so she didn't dare to move, and she was going to cry for help. And she said, I was there in a total panic. Maybe I broke my neck. I nearly fainted. My blood pressure went up, and then I cried for help. And you go like, did she take her blood pressure at that moment? Obviously not. So why is it important? She might have broken her neck at that moment. She wasn't sure, or broke her back. So what is the importance of the blood pressure? It seems so unnecessary to mention it, but since she did, and since she did in this moment of utter stress, it must have a meaning. And you don't know what meaning, but you have to find out during your consultation, because the remedy must cover this particular feeling or expression. There's another example of a little boy I'm thinking of now. He was 9 years old and he had asthma. And so he talked a little bit about his asthma. And then I asked him a little bit more direct than in adult cases, anything you're afraid of? And he said, yeah, I'm afraid of robbers. So we could stop there and look in our repertories and go, fear of robbers. And then we find, I don't know, 20, 30 remedies. But better is to ask, because many children are afraid of robbers, what do you mean? Tell me a bit more about the robbers. What can the robbers do? What are you afraid of? And he said, well, they can come in my room. They can threaten you. They can kill you. They can beat you. And then you go like, well, after they killed you, what's the point in beating you? So again, this sequence is a bit funny, isn't it? You expect to go crescendo, you know? Like beating up is bad, but being killed is even worse. In his case, this beaten up was remarkable. And you have to check. It might be something awkward because it's a boy. Eh? Maybe he doesn't think logically yet. But in many cases, most cases, majority of the cases, you must presume there is a reason. And in his case, there was, because he turned out to be a compositive. So the beaten up is in his conscious or his subconscious mind all of the time. And it pops up where you least expect it. Another example I can give you of this woman who was very, very, very depressed. That's why she came. And she said, I've been so horribly depressed since my partner left me. After I took care of him for so long, he was sick, and the moment he got better, he took the money and he left me, he betrayed me. I stopped everything in my life just to take care for him, and then off he went the moment he was better. So I was on the couch for weeks. I didn't even wash or dress. The windows, the curtains closed. I didn't go out. I was just ready to throw myself under a train, and I want to go on with my life. And then you go, yeah, I guess. But wanting to go on with your life after what you told me seems so inappropriate. There's a lot more urgent issues for the time being. It's a matter of life and death. Eh? later you can on with, go on with your life. So this, I stopped everything for him and then I want to go on with my life, is a pointer to the underlying vital sensation, because it doesn't come at the moment where you expect it. And it's like we say, when the heart is full, it comes, just pours out of your mouth. And that is what we hear in those plant kingdom remedies. So it could also be a particular way of saying something. It doesn't need to be the sequence. I recall a woman, and she was kind of, you know, I'm secretary, I'm the most important secretary in the office, the number one, I'm tough, I live on my own, but nobody knows I'm fragile in my moods. Now, this is not a common expression. I mean, not in our language, I don't think in English it's very common. To say I'm fragile in my moods. And the word fragile came again and again in other situations. So she was talking about her puberty and she said, you know, girls at that age are very fragile. And it came again and again. So in every example, the word they are conveying actually is the same, because the sensation underneath is the same. And it can escape once, it can escape twice, it's no problem, because they will say it again and again and again. Maybe with synonyms, it doesn't need to be the exact words, but it's the same sensation. And then, after so many stories, after anecdote, after image, after story, you realize it's always, what they're telling you, is always attached or detached. Or fragile and weak and broken and strong and tough, or being taken by surprise or prepared for everything. So, and again, these opposites are very typical for plant kingdom. It is said and written that opposites in plant kingdom are very typical, which is true. But we often confuse, because in other cases, we do see the opposite as well, and there is a little difference, and I will try to explain. The opposite in other cases, non-plants, let's say, is very logical. It's a psychological opposite. If you feel unsafe, let's say you need arsenicum, and you have this feeling of a threat, an uncertainty and unsafety, then of course you will try to have a lot of insurances and avoid fearful places or things where the unexpected can always happen. So the arsenicum patient who is always afraid that he will get some disease won't go to a distant island and where there's no hospital or no doctor in the neighborhood, because he doesn't take the risk, which is in a way logical. It's a psychological logic to it. The opposite is the opposite sensation. It's not quite the same. So it is mind and body, and that makes a difference. If you have this stuck feeling of this Anacardiaceae family, for instance, then they will move, they will need to move, their condition to be okay is to move, but they're not aware of it. They will say, oh, I'm a kind of person like this. That's how I am. I always been like this. I feel better when I move. Otherwise, I feel stuck, etc. So it's not only, it's psychologically as well. So it's on the mind, but it's also in the body. It's not explained fully by psychology. And often you have the two opposites given you by the patient. Not always. Sometimes it's only one side of the coin, and that depends on the myosin, how much it is compensated. But the need for the one means that there's the other side. There's the other reason to do this, there's the other motivation behind doing something. Yeah? There's something that makes them needing this. And we can then understand what is on the other side of the coin. So these opposites can ideally come spontaneously by the patient. We shouldn't ask for it. Because if you ask for it, then you get an answer to your question, which is a definition. If you ask what is the difference, what is the opposite of freedom to any patient, they will say something like imprisoned or not being able to go and do what you want, which is anybody who has a normal IQ can answer a question. And the answer is unreliable. We don't know if they say the opposite of freedom is engaged, it means a bird. We don't know, because anybody might answer this if you ask them. If it comes spontaneously, then it's reliable. That's why we should be careful not to ask too many questions too early in the case. You might want to check and confirm this at the end of the case. If you think in a certain direction, you're ready to give a bird remedy, you might ask, but most likely it won't be necessary then, because the patient will have given you many examples already. So in a plant, the same. If you have a sensation word in the beginning of the case, the first half hour, the first three quarters of an hour, and you're very tempted to check if there is an opposite, then you're sure that it's a plant remedy. I wouldn't do that, because if you say, what is the opposite of stuck? The patient most likely will give you the definition of the opposite of stuck. So does he belong to the Anacardiaceae, or did he just answer your question? You will never know, because actually you spoil the occasion. Much better is to just wait for it to come. Be aware of it, wait for it, notice it when it comes, but don't ask for it. So to recapitulate now, the plant remedies, general features, plants are reactivity. They have this plant reactivity. They relate, they react. They react to everything in their surrounding and to the homeopath. Mostly they have a vivacious, colorful speech. So they engage in everything and the consultation will be engaging. They will give you many, and many of everything. Many symptoms, many different complaints, many different modalities. They will give you many examples, many anecdotes, many stories, many, many, many. That's typical. They will express their vital sensation with common words. And this makes it difficult for us. Sometimes we feel we have a case with much information, many pages, but no picture, no pattern. That in itself might mean you are in plant kingdom. And in general, they will express their love of nature. They will prefer to do something outdoors. They will like hiking. They will do sports, but it must be outside, or they prefer to spend their holidays camping or something like that, or they like to live on the country. They need light and air, which plants do.